Welcome to Prince of Peace and Amherst Lutheran's joint worship service this morning. Together, we celebrate the events of Palm and Passion Sunday as we move from Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem to the events leading up to his death on Good Friday. I thought you all might like to hear this morning the voices of some of your friends from both Amherst and Prince of Peace. So I will share a recording that we did together earlier this week where we go deeper into the story of the days leading up to Jesus' death. I invite you now to experience worship together. And so this week is unlike any other week in the life of the church. Today we celebrate Palm Sunday, Jesus' joyous entry into Jerusalem, but we also turn to the events that follow that led to Jesus' arrest. We will do this by journeying day by day, because like our lives, Holy Week happened day by day. In our service, we will incorporate the tradition of Midrash. Midrash is an ancient Jewish tradition that weaves together the art of storytelling and the truth of Scripture, inviting us to imagine and wonder about the details that exist between the lines. Today you will hear from five voices: a woman who witnessed Jesus flip the tables in the temple, a Pharisee, the woman with the alabaster jar who anointed Jesus' feet in Bethany, Judas, and one of Jesus' disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus was arrested. As you hear these stories read aloud, we invite you to lean in. Imagine yourself there. Feel the truth of this narrative, for it was a holy week and it was a hard week. Let us begin.
It was on Sunday morning, when they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking,
"Who is this?"
The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee, and this is where the story begins."
"Who is this?"
"I heard he was a carpenter's son."
"I heard he was from Nazareth."
"Can anything good come from Nazareth?"
Who is this?
"I heard he knew John the Baptist."
"I heard he was related to John the Baptist."
"I heard he can heal people."
"Do you think he can heal me?"
"Who is he?"
"I heard he talks to Gentiles."
"I heard he talks to children."
"And women."
"And tax collectors."
"Seriously, who is this?"
"I heard he's the Son of David."
"I heard he's the Son of Man."
"I heard he's the one we've been waiting for."
"I heard he was born of a virgin."
"I heard he was born in a stable."
Who is this?
"Why is he riding a donkey?"
"How does he have so many followers?"
"Do you think Caesar knows that a man from Nazareth has been welcomed with such a large parade?"
Who is this?
"I don't know who he is, but I've heard he's gracious and kind."
"I heard he fed 5,000.
"I heard he survived the wilderness."
"I heard he helped the blind man see."
"Do you think he sees me?"
"I heard he walked on water. Is that even possible?"
"I heard he can save us."
I heard he can save all of us.
Who is this?
Who is this? This?
Hosanna's ring, thou art the King of Israel, thou David's royal son, who in the Lord's name comes, the King and blessed. All glory, Lord, and honor to the Redeemer King.
It was on Monday. Then Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who were selling and buying in the temple, and he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. He said to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer,' but you are making it a den of robbers."
I came here every Monday morning. It has always been like this, at least for as long as I can remember. My parents talk about a time when this room used to be packed with people here to pray and hear the Torah every week. They talk about those days like they were the glory days. If only we can get back to that. Now the temple is primarily a marketplace. I come here every week for the farmer's market to buy eggs and figs and food for my family. And they have the best bread. I've never felt guilty for that, because I pray on my own, and we will celebrate Passover. So is it really that big a deal? I used to think not, but that changed the day Jesus showed up. I don't know that I will ever forget that day. I had just bartered with Samuel down the street to get 2 fresh fish for my kids. That's when I heard the sound. It was so loud, a crashing, a splintering. For a brief moment, I thought God might be tearing open the walls of the temple and climbing inside. I turned around, hands full of fish, to see the money changers' tables turned over and the doves flapping wildly in their cages. Coins slowly rolled their way across the holiest of holies, and everyone froze. I've never heard silence so loud. Jesus paused and looked at the room. Quietly, he said, "My house is to be called a house of prayer. Prayer for all nations." In the quiet, I felt myself hiding the 2 fish in my hands behind my back, like Adam and Eve hid behind leaves, wishing the coins in my hands could disappear. And then, as quickly as he arrived, he turned and left. I can't be sure, but it looked like there might have been a tear running down his cheek. And for a second, I wondered to myself, maybe, just maybe, that sound really was God tearing open the walls of the temple and climbing inside. "Who is he?" you asked. "I'm not sure, but he's not like me. He's faithful. He's honest. There was nothing hiding behind his back. Have any of you ever felt that kind of shame? Have any of you ever wanted to hide something from God? Confess with me.
God, for all the things we tried to hide from you, forgive us. Amen.
It was on Tuesday. When he entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?"
"Do you know how many laws are in the Torah? 613. You know how I know that? Because I spent my entire youth memorizing them, hours upon hours upon hours of repetition. And after I mastered those, I went on to memorize the entire Torah. That's the first five books of the Bible, by the way. I spent all those hours sitting at the foot of my teacher so that I could one day teach. That's what faithfulness, sacrifice, and a life of service looks like. At least that's what I've been taught. I've talked to every scribe and priest in the land, and no one knows who taught this Jesus. No one raised him to teach. No one knows if he even passed his Torah comprehension exam. Where does he get his authority? And why are people listening to him? That is the thing that blows me away. His teachings are unorthodox. He's healed on the Sabbath. He's talked to Samaritans. He's completely disregarded our societal lines, befriends women and lepers. Does he even know how many rules he's breaking? I just don't understand. This isn't the way it's supposed to be. I studied for so long, and nothing prepared me for this. Who is he, you ask? He's a radical, a heretic, a rebel, a mystery."
It was on Wednesday. Now, while Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came to him with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment, and she poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when the disciples saw it, they were angry and said, "Why this waste? For this ointment could have been sold for a large sum and the money given to the poor." But Jesus, aware of this, said to them, "Why do you trouble the woman? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, but you will not always have me. By pouring this ointment on my body, she has prepared me for burial. Truly, I tell you, whenever this good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
It was Wednesday. I heard he was coming to Bethany. People talk about stuff like that. People also talk when you break open a bottle of perfume to anoint someone in a crowd. I learned that the hard way. In a few years, they may forget my name, but I bet they'll remember what I did. I am the woman who anointed Jesus, and it remains one of the moments in my life that I am most proud of. Jesus was at Simon's house. He often went there when he was in the city, and I knew that. We all knew that, because we could see them packed in there. It's hard to miss 12 people packed into a room. So before the sun fell, I grabbed my jar of perfume, the only item of wealth I own, and walked to Simon's. I had begged and saved for years to afford that jar of perfume. It was my backup plan, my safety net when I could no longer work, so I kept it hidden in the cupboard of my house. The whole way to Simon's house, I clutched that jar like a mother holds a baby, terrified that it might slip from my hands too soon, that I might lose the only gift I had to give. Accidentally anointing the dirt at my feet instead of the man who had healed so many. It wasn't until I walked through the door and saw Jesus sitting there that I was able to release my grip on that jar. I had made it. I had my gift, and this was the moment. The smell was unbelievable, sweet like milk and honey, but even stronger than fresh bread. I knew when I cracked that jar open, it would be overpowering. It would send people into the street. But I had to do it. People criticized me for wasting that perfume, but they don't know the whole story. They don't know what it meant to be seen and called by name. Jesus pulled me out of the wilderness of my own isolation. They have no idea the healing that Jesus offered me, and they probably could never understand what I would give to do it all over again. I mean, how do you put a price tag on life? on a full and abundant life. I don't need everyone to understand. I just needed him to understand. He gave me the gift of new life, so in return, I gave him the only thing I had. Who is this man, you ask? He was grace embodied and love let loose, and I'll never be the same.
Then one of the 12, who is called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, "What will you give me if I betray him to you?" They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that moment he began to look for an opportunity to betray him.
Could he really have been the Messiah, the Son of God? Could he really be the one that God would send to redeem the world? Really? There were days I was convinced he was, like the day he fed 5,000 people. I still can't figure out how he did it, but I was there, and people ate their fill. Or the night he told Peter to walk to him on the water. I could never begin to tell you how that happened, but I was there. It felt real. But there were other days I wasn't so sure, like the day he sent us out two by two to heal people. Did he really expect us to be able to do what he did? Or the days he rebuked the Pharisees? Could the Son of God really be that hard on people, especially the leaders of the law? I wanted to believe he was the Messiah. I really did. I wanted to give everything I had. But something deep within me wasn't settled. I was beginning to lose sleep over it. And the Pharisees began whispering in my ear, what if he wasn't all he said he was? What if everything I saw could be explained? What if I risked my life only to find out he was just another great teacher among many? It was that unsettled deep voice within me that told me to do it. That small voice was more powerful than my will, my thoughts, and my faith. It ruled me, and I followed it. Most people said I betrayed him for the money, but that would be too simple. I handed him over because I couldn't know who he was for certain. There is no black and white, no 100% proof when it comes to God. Doubt is an untamed wilderness of the mind, and that shade of gray ate at me. Who was that man, you ask? If you would have asked me last week, I would have told you, I'm not entirely sure. Ask me on Sunday, and my answer will have changed.
On the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Where do you want us to make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" He said, "Go into the city of a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says my time is near. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'" So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another, "Surely not I, Lord." He answered, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." Judas, who betrayed him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." He replied, "You have said so." While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. It was on Thursday. when Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." And going a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, "So could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, he went away for the second time and prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." Again, he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people.
It all happened so fast. It is later than I had realized, and sleep was clinging to me like a fog I couldn't shake. I heard the crowd arrive in my dreams. At first, I thought it was a crowd of people wanting Jesus to heal them. I thought selfishly to myself for just a moment, how in the world did they find us here? That's when I started to wake up. I realized the crowd didn't sound right. It wasn't people praising Jesus or begging for mercy. It was too quiet, far too quiet for that. And in the quiet, I could hear the clink of swords and sheaths. I frantically pulled myself from sleep, shaking awake my brothers and trying to stand up quickly. I saw Judas at the front of the crowd. What is he doing there? I thought. Maybe things will be okay after all, I thought, but I was wrong. In a split second, my whole world fell apart around me. I went from knowing my way, knowing my purpose, and knowing my plans, to standing in the wilderness alone. It happened as quickly as a summer thunderstorm and as slowly as the change in seasons. The crowd with clubs and swords were taking Jesus. They were taking him away, and he was not fighting it. Maybe if I had stayed awake like he had asked, then this wouldn't have happened. Maybe if we had left Jerusalem and gone back to Bethany, this wouldn't have happened. What am I supposed to tell my family? The man I have seen heal the sick and walk on water has been arrested, and the angels didn't stop it. Who is this man, you ask? He's not a criminal, that's for sure. It all happened so fast.
Who is he?
On Sunday, he was everything. The center of the parade, the center of our attention. His arrival was holy and unexpected and beautiful.
Who is he?
On Monday, he turned the world upside down. He flipped the tables while he flipped the script. I've never seen anything like it before.
Who is he?
On Tuesday, he was a teacher, but he wasn't like the other teachers. He sat and they sat. He spoke and they listened. What they don't know is he hasn't earned his place.
Who is he?
On Wednesday, he pulled me from the wilderness. He gave me the gift of new life, so I gave him all that I had. People may have stared and talked, but newness does that to people.
Who is he? On Wednesday, he was nothing more than a man worth 30 pieces of silver.
Who is he? On Thursday, he was the body broken for us, the blood shed for us. Who is he?
On Thursday, he was betrayed. He was arrested. He was treated like a convict. On Thursday, he was alone, and I was asleep.
Who is he?
It's the question everyone is asking. Beloved, this is the question of Holy Week, and it's the question of our entire lives. In order to answer this question, we have to walk through all of Holy Week, through the wilderness of betrayal and death, the wilderness of the tomb and surprise endings. Together, we will walk through the wilderness of faith, the good days, the bad days, the everyday, step by step.
Stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean, singing how marvelous, shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me, it was in the garden he prayed, now my will dying. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful am my song, shall sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died.
As we end our time of worship together this morning, I thank you for joining us, and I invite you to join us for the rest of this Holy Week, too, as we go even more deeply into the events that led to Jesus' death and resurrection. On Wednesday, we worship at 7:30 p.m. for a brief service of healing. On Monday, Thursday, we worship at 7:30 p.m. as well, and I will ask you to gather a few elements from your house before we worship so that you can go more deeply into that service. On Friday, we'll have two opportunities for worship. The first will be at 12 noon, led by Glenn and Michelle Crable. The next service will be posted to both Facebook and YouTube at 7:30 p.m. and will be a service that goes through the Passion as John tells it in his Gospel. This passion story will again be read by those that you love from Prince of Peace and Amherst. In between the pieces of the reading, you'll also get to see and experience music as shared by Adam Schmidt from Amherst and Chelsea Slager from Prince of Peace. Holy Week gives us the privilege of living in a different way some of the events that we heard this morning of the last week of Jesus's life. And so I invite you to come and join us for those. Our world, much like the world of Jesus's time, sometimes feels scary. And so I invite you to know that wherever you walk this week, as we walk in Jesus's footsteps leading up to the resurrection of Easter, that everywhere you go has already been prepared by Jesus, who has gone ahead and will meet you there. Next Sunday, we will worship together for Easter at 10 a.m. on Facebook Live. And much like those early disciples on Easter Sunday morning, we will find ourselves not like those few women at the empty tomb, but in our homes, waiting for Jesus to come and give us the peace that passes all understanding. All of our Facebook Live videos will also be shared to YouTube so that you can watch them that way. And please know that as this video ends, I invite you to post any prayer requests that you have in the comments. And know that this community will hold you and those you love in prayer this week. I know that many of you are experiencing directly COVID and its results on those you love and maybe even on yourself. Please know that the place that we most clearly see God, where we most clearly experience God's deep and abiding love for us, is at the cross. In moments of pain and suffering is when God shows up to let us know we are not alone. But please remember as well that after each of those moments, there is again the promise of new life, of resurrected life on this side of the grave or the next. So keep your eyes open this week to all the ways God is coming to you in worship, in kindness, in a moment where you are able to catch your breath. And know that you are being held by a community of people who are not afraid to walk the way of Jesus with you. And so may the peace of Christ be with you always. And may God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this day and all week as you walk the way of Jesus's passion, as you walk through this life.